Hello, welcome back, guys, to our final part of lecture four. The last thing we talked about is the equilibrium condition of Bain junction, in which there is no, or the junction is not connected to any voltage source. In that, you know, part, we're gonna start to connect, you know, the Bain junction to a source. In other words, we are putting it in a circuit. Okay, so we have two conditions for connecting the Bain junction to a source, a voltage source in specific. Okay, the first one is called the reverse bias condition or reverse connection, and the second one is called the forward bias. Okay, we're gonna study in that part the reverse bias condition. So in the reverse bias condition, as you see here, the positive terminal of the voltage source is connected to the N, and the negative terminal of the voltage source is connected to the B. And now the question is, what will happen, you know, to the junction, to the depletion region, for example, when we connect a voltage source with such a polarity, such that the positive terminal is connected to or close to the N side, the negative terminal is close to or connected to the B side. And the answer actually is just in front of you. The depletion region will increase. I mean, we will have more ions, either negative ions on the B side or positive ions on the N side. And its length will increase as well, or width, okay? And the reason here is just you can guess it by yourself. It's not fancy, you know, stuff or something. Basically, because remember that this built-in potential or built-in or you know barrier, it has many names: the built-in potential, contact potential, barrier potential, okay, or built-in field, barrier potential field. You know, all this potential or this field was in prohibiting or stopping the flow of electrons from N side to B side and from the holes from B side to N side, okay? And we said that this, you know, negative terminal, this negative electrode here will prevent the motion of electrons in that direction because they are basically, not attracted because they are basically, you know, repulsed from the similar charge, which is negative. And the positive electrode here will prevent the holes to move to the inner side because basically holes are positive and they are repulsed or not attracted to the this positive terminal or this positive electrode or ions in that case, okay? And just if we look to the terminals of this voltage source here, it actually helps more to prevent the motion. So we remember we are putting positive here. And we are putting negative here. Okay, I mean this positive side here, you know, become more more positive, and this negative side on the B side become more negative. Okay, you can think of it in another way. That since here there are electrons which are negative, and they are connected to the positive terminal, so some of them will just flow to the positive terminal of the battery and just absorb it there. And whenever electron leaves the inside, it will leave behind a positive ion. So that's why we have, you know, extra ions here, those guys, those extra ones. And remember that on the B side, we have positive holes. And whenever a hole sees, you know, a negative polarity of the battery, it will, it can flow, some of them will flow to the negative terminal of the battery and just absorb it there. And whenever a hole leaves the N site, the B site, it will leave behind a negative ion. Those extra ones here. So you can just imagine that these are the original ones, these two columns here. And this column and this column is the newly created ones. Okay. And look at this. So the weights here has increased. So basically this was from this point to this point, the original weights due to V naught or VBI. And now due to VR, this is a new width due to VR, the reverse. So we can, you know, summarize that in the following, that some electrons in the N site attracted to the positive terminal of the battery and absorb it there in the battery. I mean, whenever an electron leaves the negative, the N site, N type or N site, call it whatever, it leaves you behind a positive ion. Same for the holes in the B site. But holes are directed to the negative terminal and leaves behind negative ions. So the depletion region, the depletion region widen more. And we can expect that if at equilibrium the current is zero, that this will help to maintain such a property, that the current will still be zero or very small. Okay. That's basically, you know, what's going to happen when we connect a battery in with such polarity. Now, what happens if we increase this reverse bias? If we increase this applied potential, it was, you know, 5, let's make it 10. You know, basically, it will attract more holes from the B side and more electrons from the N side, and the depletion region will widen more. And here is an example where VR2 is greater than VR1. That's why here we have, you know, a wider, let's call this W2, the width of the depletion region when we have VR2. And let's call this W1, the width of the depletion region when we have VR1. So based on that, W2 is greater than W1. And one possible application for that is that we can make a capacitor out of this structure here, this, you know, reverse biasing of the B in junction. This can be thought as a capacitor, by the way. How is this? So let's first think, what is capacitor? A capacitor is conductor, another conductor, and insulator in between. So this is a conductor. This is another conductor. And between we have insulator. But you know, normal capacitors that we made, is we are fixed. You know, just one plate, and that's it. And if we want to change the you know the value, you can make a mechanical capacitor that you can you know control the distance between the two capacitors mechanically. I mean, using your hand. Okay, and the capacitance itself. And the capacitance mean how many the capacitance of the charge, how much charge we can carry on that, or that capacitor can store, is equal to epsilon, which is a property of the material. That's our not our discussion here. Epsilon multiplied by the area, the cross section area of the capacitor, over d, the distance between the two blades. This is d. And that's why I'm talking about this mechanical capacitor in which you can control its capacitance by controlling mechanically the distance between the two plates, you know, just a mechanical result, like just like the old radios, you know, when you change the station, this knob that you change, if it's a mechanical capacitor, it will change the distance between the two plates. Now the question, do we have the same here? Yes, we have. Certainly we have. So we need two conductors, something that can conduct the current. And this is one conductor. This is another conductor. So the first conductor is actually the B-type site. This is the B-type site. Or the B site. And the second conductor is the N type site. Because basically, if we imagine that we can cut this side and connect it to the battery, there will be a current flowing. Again, for the N type site, if we just cut it from the B junction and connect the battery, it will conduct. Remember, these two sites, the N and B site, have free carriers. Holes or electrons. So they are conductors. But where is the depletion? I'm sorry, where is the insulator here? What is the definition of insulator? I will answer you. The definition of an insulator is a material that cannot conduct current, right? It may have a charge. That's okay. And at that time, these charges shouldn't move. So they cannot contribute to the current. That's the definition of insulator. You can have insulator with positive and negative charges. That's okay, as long as they are not moving under a voltage or a potential voltage difference. And that's our case here. So in our case, the insulator is a depletion region. So here, the first conductor in our BN capacitor now, the first conductor is, for example, in inside region or in region. Second conductor is the B site. The insulator is the depletion region. It has ions. Negative and positive, but they are not contributing to the current. They cannot move. That's why it can be considered as insulator. So in principle, and actually practically, we can make you know, a capacitor out of this. And actually this capacitor has advantage because we can control it. We can control using the voltage, the reverse voltage. We can control the distance, which is the width of the depletion region. That's why we can control its the capacitance. So you can make a radio now. I think in your car now, I don't think they are using, you know, mechanical capacitors anymore. So basically, when you change the station in your car, you are actually changing a varactor capacitance. And this is called basically the varactor diode. And this is, you know, the first we are now encountering diodes. Actually, PN junction is just a diode. Okay. So, and this is it's a symbol. So the symbol of the diode is just like this. This is a symbol of a diode. But this diode is a special case because it's only used in reverse bias. And since it's used as a capacitor, so we just add another bar here on top of the original symbol just to represent the capacitance. And this arrow to show that it can be controlled. We can control its value. Okay, but to use something in a circuit, you should know its properties. You should calculate the capacitance in that case, as the original capacitance, which is inductor insulator, metal insulator. You know the equation. You know how to deal with it. You know how to design a circuit because you can. You know how you change the capacitance. So we need also equations here. So there are some derivations we are not, we will not cover in that course, in which you can basically drive expressions for the capacitances. So here is the capacitance, and zero here means when VR equal to zero. No reverse bias. You have only the depletion region at equilibrium. So at equilibrium, if you measure this capacitor, if you measured at equilibrium, the PN junction can be considered as a capacitor. And here is the value of its capacitance. But one caveat here, this is farad per meter square, per unit area. We measure capacitances in farads, okay? So this capacitance, CJ note, and J here for junction, because we have junction now. Okay, and as I said, zero for, because there is no bias. It's equilibrium. For VR is equal to zero. This is farad per meter square. So to know the actual capacitance, you should multiply by the cross-section area of the PN junction. Good. Now the question, what is the relation between, if we increase the reverse bias, what will be the new value for the capacitance? And here is the relation that relates the junction capacitance at any value for the of the reverse. Okay, and two caveats now. So we have first caveat is that again CJ is farad per meter square, just like CJ naught. This is one thing. The other one, VR here is negative. It's not a positive. Usually reverse bias, because they are reverse. So you usually express them as negative, okay? This particular equation, you may find another version of it. You may find it in that way. CG note divided by 1 plus VR over V note. And in that case, that doesn't mean the V reverse is positive. In that case, the consider the definition, since we say it's a reverse voltage, then the sense of reverse is in its name itself. So they express it in positive. And I will tell you what to do in the exam. Don't worry whether to put negative or positive. Don't worry about that, okay? But the common sense tells you it should be negative. I mean, what's under the root, square root should be positive all the time, okay? So, but I will tell you what to do exactly. Okay. I personally prefer the second one, this one, but this is the one in the book. And the both just, magnitude around the VR. So just always 1 plus magnitude VR over V naught. And just peace of mind, okay, about negative and positive and stuff. So let's adopt the second version, this version, but I just, you know, highlighted this one because it's in the book, Razavi's book. Okay, so CG naught divided by square root of 1 plus magnitude of Vr over V naught. And V naught is the barrier potential for VDI. So this is the built-in potential. Or barrier potential or contact potential. VBR. Call it whatever. Okay. One last observation here is that one of the applications, as I said, the radio, for example, in your car. But what is inside the radio? So we have something called oscillator. And the oscillators, you need a lot, these variable capacitors, okay? Let's go back a little bit to, you know, to your lab, okay? So I am sure that you used in one of the devices in the lab called function generator, okay? So basically, in function generator, when you, if you want, for example, a sine wave or a square wave, okay, you can control the output frequency, okay? So basically, what's inside this function generator is oscillators, okay? You may have one oscillator that you can drive using some manipulation, mini signals, or may know you may have an oscillator for the triangular wave, or another oscillator for the sine wave, and so on, okay? But one common thing between all of them is that to change the frequency, okay, you must have, you know, some way to change the capacitor value, okay? And all the oscillators, you know, depend on this circuit here. You know, this is the main component in any oscillator, okay? It's what makes it oscillate in the first place, because this what's called resonance circuit. This is called resonance circuit. Okay. And based on the value of L and C, L is the inductor inductance, and C is the capacitor capacitance. Okay, you can determine if the output frequency. So the output frequency, the output frequency of the resonant or of the oscillator, that's better, of the oscillator depends on the L and C values in the resonance circuit. You don't need to know what's exactly an oscillator. You know, it's advanced topic. It's also another circuit, by the way, but it's advanced topic. It's not covered in this course. But this oscillator depended heavily on that resonance circuit here, which is just, you know, inductor in parallel with a capacitor. Okay. And basically, to change the output frequency of the output signal that this oscillator will generate, signals for us. This is the function generator. Okay, we change the capacitance. How to change the capacitance? Make this capacitance as a varactor, and they change its reverse bias. That will change its value. So this will change the output frequency. Finally, the oscillation frequency, if oscillation is equal to 1 over 2 pi square root of L C. And you see now, using this equation, that really the output frequency is dependent on the value of the inductance and the capacitance. So let's take an example now. So this example in Razavi's book, okay, it's a very good example. So basically here we have a beam junction, the N site is doped, or the B site is doped with acceptor atoms with density 2 × 10^16 per centimeter cubed. The N site is doped by 9 × 10^15 centimeter cubed. Determine the capacitance of the device at a reverse voltage of 0, which is CG naught, and a reverse voltage of 1. So let's start by A here. At VR equal to 0, basically the capacitance is CG naught. So we have the equation. I will just write it again for you. Epsilon silicon. So epsilon is just a constant, okay? And just on a side here, epsilon for any material equal to epsilon r, epsilon naught. Epsilon naught is epsilon for the space, free space. And it's constant. I think it's 8.85 × 10^-12. And epsilon r is material dependent based on the material. For silicon, epsilon r silicon is equal to 11.7. But I will give you all these numbers, you know, in exam or a book. You don't need to memorize them. So epsilon silicon q over forgot here over 2, yeah, over 2, then Na Nd over Na plus Nd 1 over V naught, which is the barrier potential. Okay, just take a check here. So yeah, that's right. Okay, good. We know Na, we know Nd, epsilon r is 11.7, epsilon naught 8.85 × 10^-12. Now what is V naught? So we need to know V naught. So V naught, we take it. So V naught, which is the barrier potential, is equal to Kt over Q. If you remember, guys, from last lecture or last video, I'm sorry, ln in A in D over Ni squared. Remember, this is silicon, so Ni is equal to 10^10 per centimeter cubed. Per centimeter cubed. Carrier per centimeter cubed. Okay. But we are not done yet. So one thing here before you just compensate in the equation, remember the units. These particular questions, usually you guys messed up just because of the units. Okay, so you have here Ni, Ni and Nd in A all in per centimeter cubed. Good. Q has no relation with meter or centimeter. V naught is just a voltage, okay? The problem is in epsilon naught. So this value here, as far as I remember, I think it's farad per meter square. I think so, okay? It is, you know, it is something per meter square, for sure, okay? So you guys should, you know, convert this into centimeter, or, you know, convert this either Na or Nd into meters. You have both options, okay? But you should have everything in either centimeter or meters, okay? And the final answer will be farad per meter square if you used everything in meters, or farad per centimeter squared if you used everything in centimeter. This is also important observation, because for some other examples, we need the absolute value for the capacitance. So this is, remember, this is the capacitance per unit area. So in that particular examples, you need to multiply by the capacitance afterwards, by the area afterwards. So if your capacitance is for example, farad per centimeter square or farad per meter square, you need to convert the area into meter or centimeter square according to the unit of the area that you used in your capacitance, okay? So basically, if you compensate, the correct answer should be 2.65 × 10^-8 farad centimeter square, per centimeter square, okay? Good. Now number B, add VR equal to 1. You know the equation. Cj equal to Cj naught divided by square root of 1 plus magnitude of VR. We'll use, you know, the second version of the equation, you know, to have a piece in our mind. So over VR, I'm sorry, over V naught. Yes, over V naught. We know V naught, we calculated it here. Okay, VR now as a magnitude is just 1. And you have a piece of mind again. And Cj naught we calculate from the first, you know, from A, part A. And this will be 0.172 10 to the power minus 9 farad per micrometer square. Okay, this is actually example. So I just take the, you know, the numbers from there. Okay, guys. So this is basically, you know, the Bean junction under reverse bias condition, and we started to hear now our first device, which is diode, because under this conditions, the reverse bias condition, the Bean junction can be considered as a diode, and this diode can be used as a variable capacitor. Okay, and this variable capacitor has many applications, especially in oscillators, function generators, you know, your radio in your car, and so on. Okay, guys, so this is, you know, the conclusion of the lecture four. And next time we're gonna start with the forward bias condition and, you know, more interesting applications for the diode. So see you next week. Bye-bye.